China showing signs of frustration and irritation as the Philippines continues to conduct resupply missions to Ayungin Shoal. That's according to international affairs analyst Renato De Castro. See, China's Coast Guard condemned Wednesday's resupply mission to the BRP Sierra Madre, claiming Philippine vessels entered its waters in the Spratly Islands without permission. De Castro believes China's Coast Guard won't hesitate to use other tactics to block Philippine vessels from reaching the BRP Sierra Madre.
So what China is basically sending us is this will be a dynamics between the Chinese Coast Guard, which of course has been given the legal mandate in 2021 to basically assert China's expansive claim in the South China Sea, and of course the Philippine Coast Guard, which has been given mandate by this current administration to assert basically what we believe is our maritime entitlement in the South China Sea. China is on an offensive. China is in a mode for what what has been mentioned, a maritime expansion. So sooner than later, China would have to escalate this by possibly ordering the Coast Guard to use lethal force. And of course, that is provided in the new 2021 Chinese Coast Guard law.
The Philippines completed its latest resupply mission to Ayungin Shoal October 4th, but not without encountering dangerous maneuvers from Chinese vessels. House Speaker Martin Romualdez denying politics was involved in the realignment of confidential funds of Vice President Sara Duterte. Romualdez said such observations are mere speculation. See, some analysts earlier said the move could be a strategic play by Romualdez ahead of the 2028 elections, but he says there is no truth to that.
People are reading too much into it. No, I think it's very, very straightforward and simple. No, so the CIF had the topic. It all came up. No, and there were a lot of discussions and debates in the House. No, and so borrowing the words of the Vice President, that even she says that she could live without it. And she would leave it to the sound discretion of the Congress for its proper disposition. Under the circumstances, we felt that it would best be realigned to the agencies and to the departments and into the areas where we have just mentioned that are a priority.
Romualdez also agrees with Duterte, confidential and intelligence funds must be used to ensure peace and security, but he says such funds should be given to agencies with that mandate.
With respect to the confidential funds, we are all for the confidential funds, and we are all for peace, no, and security, no. We are all for that. So yes, we are one. We are one with the Vice President in having to make sure that confidential and intelligence funds, you know, are always part of the equation. And of course, best left with the agencies and departments, no, that are most and best suited.
Duterte earlier slammed critics of her confidential funds, branding them enemies of the state. The word war between Vice President Duterte and opposition lawmakers rages on. ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro slams Duterte for her remark. Those opposing her secret funds are enemies of the state. Castro says this comment is ill-advised and shows the president's lack of transparency. The lawmaker urges Duterte, who is also the concurrent education chief, to just focus on solving issues hounding the education sector.
Ayaw niya talagang bitawan yung kanyang confidential fund despite the statements na she can live without it. Kung siya ay para sa peace and order, kapayapaan, ay hindi naman kailangan ito ng confidential fund kasi nagagawa naman niya ng mga iba't ibang mga leader kahit na nung panahon ni Vice President Leni Robredo, hindi naman talaga kinailangan yan. Kaya i-give up niya na yon kasi hindi naman mandate ng kanyang opisina yung sinasabing surveillance, kasi yun ang paggagamitan ng confidential fund, surveillance, paniniktik at iba pa. Kaya dapat i-give up niya na yan at mag-focus siya dun sa mga problema natin sa education.
The unemployment rate in the Philippines eases to 4.4% in August. This translates to 2.21 million jobless Filipinos for that month, an improvement from July's 2.27 million. The underemployment rate also fell to 11.7% in August. Month on month, the industries that added the most jobs in August include agriculture and forestry, construction and education. On the flip side, the sectors of information and communication, financial and administrative support service activities saw the largest monthly drop. The National Economic and Development Authority attributes the latest job figures to government's efforts to create high-quality and high-paying jobs. The NEDA, however, admits more needs to be done. It vows to bring in more investments to the country, which will lead to job creation. A big-time price rollback seen next week. Gasoline prices are projected to fall by almost 3 pesos per liter, while a liter of diesel and kerosene might see a 2 peso rollback. If the Energy Department's estimates hold up, this will be the third straight week of oil price cuts after an 11-week streak of price increases.
Ang una pong kadahilanan pa rin, yung takot ng mataas na interest rate na ini-implement particularly ng Amerika at ng European countries. Alam naman po natin, pag mataas ang interest rate, bumababa ang demand. And then ang second naman po, yung stronger dollar din po. So kapag lakas ang dolyar, kasi ang ating petroleum product, dollar-dominated commodity, so kapag mataas yun, bumababa naman yung mga halaga ng ibang mga denomination ng ibang bansa, so bumababa din po yung mga pagbili natin sa produktong petroleum. Kung magsusunod-sunod yung ganitong klaseng sitwasyon o mame-maintain, makakaranas tayo ng rollback. Pero huwag po natin kalilimutan ng yung ibang lingering factors para tumaas ang presyo. Kasi nasa sitwasyon po tayo ng tight supply. Di po ba dahil dun sa production cut na in-extend ng Saudi Arabia at ng Russia.
A senior official of the Department of Agriculture sees the price of rice going down this month to as low as 36 pesos per kilo. Jervis Manahan gives us the details.
Agriculture Senior Undersecretary Domingo Panganiban sees rice prices dropping to as low as 36 pesos per kilo this October. He made this projection a day after President Marcos lifted the price ceiling on the staple grain. His reason: more supply due to the harvest season. Panganiban believes rice prices would have been much higher last month if not for the price ceiling. He said government continues to take steps to further reduce the price of rice. For now, the retail price of rice in Manila ranges from 40 to 62 pesos per kilo in wet markets.
I am for the program that the president is advocating, which is right now a program of government that is lowering the cost of the price of rice in the market. And secondly, advocating a food security program.
Senate Agriculture Committee Chair Cynthia Villar, for her part, says she still cannot understand why rice prices have been going up.
The rice farmer in Nueva Ecija produce rice, palay at 8 pesos per kilo. Pag maging rice yun, 16. So talagang kayang-kaya namang ibenta ng mura eh. Yung inefficient na rice farmer, 12 ang puhunan nila, times 2, 24. So makikita ka pa rin sa 38, di ba? Oh, kaya I cannot understand why the prices are going up.
Villar admitted the Philippines is not efficient in rice production, as neighboring countries such as Thailand and Vietnam can produce rice at lower cost. The senator also said she is in favor of importation as long as tariffs will be collected. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
President Marcos leads another round of distribution of smuggled rice to beneficiaries of government's poverty alleviation program in Capiz. Joining him there, former Senator and Liberal Party President Mar Rojas.
Alam niyo po, kami ni Mar, matagal na po kaming magkaibigan. At kahit na hindi kami magkapanig kuminsan sa politika, matagal kaming nagsama sa New York. At sana naman habang nandito siya, hindi na niya kinikwento yung mga nangyari sa amin nung nasa New York kami, dahil bachelor pa po kami at marami kaming adventure na magkasama.
During the event, Marcos called on lawmakers to immediately pass the Agricultural Economic Sabotage Bill, which seeks heavier penalties for smugglers and hoarders.
Nakikipag-ugnayan din tayo sa Kongreso na maamyendahan ng ilang batas upang tuluyan ng maging krimen ang agricultural economic sabotage at mapabigat ang parusa dito. Mga kababayan, gaano man kalaki ang kanilang sindikato, tulad na natimbog natin sa nasmuggler sa pier ng Zamboanga noong buwan ng Agosto, wala pong binabatbat yan sa nagkakaisang nating lakas.
Around 1,000 beneficiaries in Capiz received rice packs. Marcos will head to Antique and Aklan this afternoon, also to distribute rice. Authorities seize a huge shipment of illegal drugs at the Manila International Container Port, estimated to be worth over 2 billion pesos. Our very own Jeff Caparaz is there, and he now joins us with details. Jeff, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, good afternoon. Joint illegal drugs interdiction operation of the Philippine National Police, Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency, and Bureau of Customs have seized 1,109 pieces of cling wrap packs at Container Freight Station 3 at the Manila International Container Port here in Isla Puting Bato, Barangay 20, Tondo, Manila, Thursday morning. The plastic packs contains white crystalline substance believed to be shabu, and according to a report from PNP Drug Enforcement Group, the contraband weighs more than 300,000 grams, amounting to more than 2.1 billion pesos or 2,197,651,200 pesos. They are found inside boxes and individually they are wrapped in carbon paper and aluminum foil. Authorities are still investigating the point of origin of the illegal drugs and its sender as well as the consignee. The recovered pieces of drug evidence will be turned over to the Pideat Crime Laboratory for laboratory examination. Investigation is still ongoing as to the circumstances behind the delivery and confiscation of said illegal drugs.